Okay, so we'll now kick off with Mark, who's presenting on Tomcat 8 update. So thanks for being here, Mark, and we look forward to the next 45 minutes. We have some time at the end for Q&A, so thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellent. Applause. And I haven't even said anything yet. Marvellous. Right. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Mark Thomas. I'm employed by VMware, but I spend most of my time working on Apache Tomcat. So the agenda for this session is really sort of an overview of where we are on Tomcat 8. So I'll do a little bit of introduction and then look at the Java EE 7 aspects of Tomcat 8 and then the Tomcat specific stuff. Because really every major Tomcat version falls into those two categories. Those bits that are part of the specs and those sort of non-spec things that Tomcat is implementing. Then go on to look at timescales, finish off with some final thoughts and then some questions at the end. And my aim is to leave about 15 minutes for questions. I'm happy to take questions as we go along and we can sort of adjust the time of the talk and the questions accordingly. I think essentially we've got an hour and we can fill it in whichever way we feel useful. So by way of introduction, the reason I'm up here today talking about Tomcat 8 is, unsurprisingly, I'm a committer on the Apache Tomcat project. I do various other bits of things at the ASF as well, infrastructure, security, a few bits of commons. And at VMware, my day job, I do actually get to spend most of my time, as I said, working on Tomcat. A few other bits and pieces I do there are really Tomcat related, and it's taking Tomcat and then feeding it into TC Server, which is VMware's product built on top of Tomcat. I also have to do a little bit of customer support there. Again, that's around Tomcat and TC Server. So I do spend most of my time working, as I say, on Tomcat. So Java EE 7, the specs are due spring. So that's a slightly movable feast, but one would hope it was going to be in the next few months. And as far as Tomcat 8 is concerned, there are four specifications that we're interested in. And this is a change from Tomcat 7. In Tomcat 7, it was just the servlet, the JSP, and the expression language specifications. In Tomcat 8, we're adding a new specification, the WebSocket spec. Now, Tomcat 7 does support WebSockets, but it does it through its own API. So in Tomcat 8, we're going to be supporting the standard Java API for WebSockets. There's not really a huge amount of demand for any other of the Java EE specifications in Tomcat. Various other specifications get mentioned now and again. All of them are available via other libraries that you can add to Tomcat if you want. If you want a full web container, then you can use Apache Tommy. If you want a full J2E server, then you've got Apache Geronimo. And both of those, won't be a surprise, are themselves built with Tomcat providing the servlet, the JSP, and the expression language. And one of the things that's come up a couple of times in the last year is the Java authentication SPI for containers. But if truth be told, it's been mentioned more often by people writing the specification than it has by people that want to use it. So on that basis, we probably won't provide support for it. If that picture changes, if we have a large number of users saying, actually, that would be really useful if that was in Tomcat, you know, please, 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 will you do it, much like they did for WebSocket, where there was a real groundswell of users saying, yes, we want WebSocket in Tomcat, then, yes, JazzPick could be added to Tomcat fairly easily. The fact that Apache Tommy and Geronimo have already implemented it means that it's not quite, but near enough to copy, paste, done, thank you very much. So it's doable, but there needs to be a demand. And that really goes for any of the other Java EE specifications. The reason that Tomcat doesn't support the web profile is that there wasn't a groundswell of demand for that from the user base. So the Tomcat community will respond to what the users want, and at the minute, that's servlet, JSP, expression language, and WebSocket. So let's look at each of those in turn. First of all, Servlet 3.1. I'm a member of the Servlet 3.1 expert group. This is my first time being a member of the expert group this way around. I'm actually down as officially a representative of VMware. Apache itself doesn't have any representatives in the JSRs anymore. I wanted to be an individual representative, but the VMware lawyers basically said, we're not signing the piece of paper that Oracle wants us to sign, so you can be an individual member. You'll have to be a member as VMware. So, fine, you know, price we have to pay sometimes. I did make clear to them, if VMware asked me to do anything that I didn't agree with, I was going to start the email, my employer has told me to say this, I don't agree. That hasn't happened at all. They've left me to get on and essentially represent Tomcat's interests to the expert group. So the latest draft that's publicly available for Servlet 3.1 is January 2013. So it's a bit over a month old now. And Servlet 3.1 is looking at a number of new features. First of all, non-blocking I/O. Now, this is potentially really interesting. Servlet API to this point has been completely blocking in terms of I/O. Now that non-blocking I/O has been introduced, it's been introduced as an addition to the servlet input stream and servlet output stream. So it's a little bit different to what you might be used to, and you do not have access to the underlying socket. That means you sort of need a slight change of mindset about how you're actually using it. But fundamentally, you can do everything that you'd want to be able to do. That non-blocking I/O itself supports HTTP upgrade. That is primarily there as a hook for the WebSocket specification to hook into, but potentially any other protocol that you can use HTTP upgrade with, you could then write something to sit on top of Servlet 3.1. The other small change in terms of functionality is the ability to change session ID on authentication. And it's a little thing, but it's there to prevent session fixation attacks. And the fact that you can now do it through the API means that security frameworks that sit on top of servlet containers can now trigger that session change without having to do some of the truly horrible hacks that they were having to do in the past to achieve the same aim. Beyond that, there's a lot of clarification of ambiguities, quite a few typos that have been fixed, and generally, one of the things I've been trying to do is, if I look back over the last few years, there are numerous Tomcat bug reports that have ended with, yes, I know the servlet spec is ambiguous, but the expert group, what they meant when to write was this. Therefore, that's the functionality that Tomcat's implemented. And we've tried to get those clarifications back into the spec, so it is then more obvious to users moving forward. There's a couple of things that are TBD. Primarily, this is protection for uncovered HTTP methods. There's a... let's call it a feature of early versions of the servlet spec, where if you created a security constraint that said, this URL with this HTTP method is only accessible by users in this role, that was fine, that all worked. But a consequence of that was that that same URL with any other HTTP method you care to mention is open to everybody. And not everybody realized that when they were writing their security constraints. And if they did realize it, they probably forgot that there's actually nothing stopping a client sending any HTTP method name they like, whether it's in RFC 2616 or not, and a servlet will respond to it by default. A JSP will respond to it by default. A servlet won't, but a JSP will. So that potentially creates security holes. And there have been various discussions on the expert group that how this should be handled. I won't bore you with all of that discussion. Suffice to say, I think the solution that's going to be adopted isn't the right one. I think I've lost that argument. So what's probably going to happen, it's not certain yet because I haven't seen it in a draft, is that a new configuration option will be added to WebXML that basically says, if anywhere in web.xml there's a security constraint that says this URL, this method, this role, all other methods will be automatically denied unless explicitly allowed elsewhere. And that will certainly block the security hole. The issues I have with it is you don't actually know you've got a security hole unless something tells you. So you need logging or something to say, hang on a minute, I've just parsed web.xml. And it looks like you've got a security hole here, you might want to do something. And if we're going to tell the users to do something, then we may as well tell them to use the features that already exist in Servlet 3 to plug the hole rather than yet another feature. But like I say, I've lost that argument, I think. One feature that's been dropped is the idea of overlays. And what was behind this was you could take effectively a template WAR file and say, right, here's my template, add these bits over here and turn it into a web app and deploy it. And the idea was it was really around multi-tenancy, so you could have one basic web app that you could then customize for different customers. Unfortunately, this was actually the first bit of implementation I did, and just as I got it finished, it got dropped. So support for it is there in Tomcat 8 as sort of a container-specific feature, but in terms of the servlet API, then that functionality is not there. So that's really what's happening in servlet 3.1. JSP 2.3, there is no JSP expert group. There will be a maintenance release. Much like JSP 2.2 is going to be fairly late, I suspect it will be at the same time as the sort of the public releases of all the other specs are made, then there'll be a maintenance release made of JSP. There's essentially not that much to do. JSP is finished. There's not a great deal of functionality that needs to be added to it, if any. There will be a few updates in light of the changes to the expression language that I'm going to talk about in a few moments. And one of the potential changes that the person doing the maintenance release has agreed is a good idea, but again, until I actually see it in the spec, we won't know for certain that it's in, is that the idea of JSPs responding to all HTTP methods regardless, because it does have some potential security implications, is to provide a way of limiting it or limiting them by default. And I think what we're going to end up with is a specification recommendation to limit JSPs to heads, gets, and posts, and with some container-specific configuration to expand that list if you want. Moving on to the expression language then. This is expression language 3.0, and it's a new major version. The last one was 2.2, and it is significantly different. As I say, I am part of the expert group, but I must confess I haven't been involved in this expert group as much as I have been in the others. This really, the entire expert group for expression language has been like that. None of the experts have been that involved. It's really all been driven by the specification lead. As I said, there are significant changes. It's getting rather closer to Java than it is at the minute. And my sort of underlying concern, but I don't really have sort of anything concrete to hang it on, is it getting too close to Java? Is it trying to do too much? Is it getting too complicated? I'm uncomfortable, but I say I don't have anything specific that I can say that's a problem because it's just a general level of discomfort. So the sorts of things that are being added, access to static methods and fields, lambda expressions, that's one big piece of functionality. You can see a couple of examples up on the screen there. And collection operators. Now, originally, this was going to be aligned with LingQ, so it would use similar sort of syntax. A number of people did raise some concerns in that, well, that's great, but, and the but being that Java 8 was probably going to do something different. And that went back and forth for a bit. There was a change a couple of months ago that basically all of the LingQ stuff was dropped and alignment with Java 8 was brought in. Fortunately, I hadn't implemented anything this time because that would have been really annoying. So there's a fair amount of work to be done on that. And as we'll come on to in timescales in a minute, not a huge amount of progress in Tomcat on actually implementing it yet. A couple of other operators. String concatenation, the list of operators that are valid for string concatenation has been getting shorter and shorter and shorter. I think we're down to just one now due to various issues. That won't be backwards compatible with that, and that might be confusing because of that. So plus equals is how I think string concatenation is going to be done. It's added the assignment operator, the semicolon, so essentially you can have a statement that doesn't get displayed, effectively gets processed and then thrown away. And the ability to access classes directly, which of course you need in order to be able to access static methods and static fields. The final Java specification from Java E7 that's in Tomcat 8 is WebSocket. And again, I'm part of the expert group here. Tomcat 7, as I said, already does support it, but through its own API. We haven't yet decided, and when I say we, I mean the Tomcat developer community as a whole, what's going to happen to sort of the Tomcat-specific WebSocket API that exists in Tomcat 7 at the minute. Currently, it's in Tomcat 7, and it's in the Tomcat 8 code base. What I think is going to happen, and if you're in the Apache Way talk earlier, this is just me thinking, it's not a decision because it didn't happen on the mailing list, but what I think is going to happen is the Tomcat-specific support will be removed from Tomcat 8. Tomcat 8 will just support the new APIs. The new APIs will be backported to Tomcat 7. All of the hooks are there, so that's not a problem. And then the Tomcat-specific API will be deprecated in Tomcat 7, so there'll be one standard API for WebSocket moving forward. But those folks that are using WebSocket on Tomcat 7 with the Tomcat-specific API at the minute, they'll still be able to carry on doing that for the life of Tomcat 7 anyway. It's actually not that bad migrating one from the other. The Tomcat API is a lot simpler, so moving to the Java API isn't that difficult. I did it for the Tomcat examples in about 10 minutes each. Okay, they're fairly simple examples, but it's a relatively simple process. WebSocket 1.0 provides an API for both clients and servers, and Tomcat will support both. In previous incarnations of this presentation, I've said, well, we'll definitely support the server side, not so sure about the client side. But the way the specification's been constructed, you pretty much have to support, you have to write 99.9% of the client implementation in order to do the server one. So we may as well provide that last little bit and provide the client implementation as well. We are aiming to do this in a container-neutral way, so you should be able to take these WebSocket jars and drop them in any Servlet 3.1 container and get WebSocket support. That is currently the case. We don't use any Tomcat-specific APIs, and I haven't yet seen anything in the stuff that we haven't implemented that suggests that we might need to go down that route. So in terms of having a portable implementation, it looks like that's going to be possible. Features that WebSocket 1.0 adds on top of Tomcat's simple implementation. The first one is encoding and decoding. And there's been lots of debate about this on the expert group mailing lists. And primarily, it's providing a mechanism that lets the developer say, hey, here's this object. I don't care how you do it. Just use WebSocket and get it from this server to that client or vice versa. And how that's implemented and how flexible that is and how many different types of objects you can support, there's been quite a lot of debate on that. But that, I think, has now come to a sensible conclusion, and it's at a point where it can be implemented, and I've done some of it for Tomcat, but not all of it. There's support for annotations, so you can define a WebSocket endpoint just with an annotation. So you can take an ordinary POJO, and you can turn it into a WebSocket endpoint very, very quickly. There are some examples of that in the Tomcat 8 codebase at the minute, so you can see how the Tomcat 8 examples have been put together, and they all use POJOs, so it's really nice and simple. One of the big differences is that Tomcat's WebSocket implementation that's in 7 blocks within a frame. So once you start reading a message, the process of reading all of that message is a blocking read. Once you start writing a message, it's a blocking write. And hands up, I did that because it was quicker and it was simpler. And putting non-blocking in there was going to take me longer. And nobody made a huge amount of fuss at the time that non-blocking wasn't available. So WebSocket 1.0 does provide non-blocking reads and writes. You've actually got a choice. You can use blocking or non-blocking. It's entirely up to you. Both are available. That actually creates some interesting fun and games under the bonnet because you have to do all of those reads and writes through the non-blocking API provided via the Servlet 3.1, and getting blocking writes and reads through that is, as I say, a little entertaining. But as developers, you won't need to worry about that. If any of you are interested in contributing to Tomcat and in the WebSocket area, then yes, you will need to have a quick look at that. I said that WebSocket 1.0 was non-blocking. It does actually work with the blocking Java I/O connector as well. It's obviously not really non-blocking. Essentially, every time you do a read and write, it does it blocking and then just pretends that, oh, now the write's finished or the read's finished, and then triggers whatever event, whether it's a future or the completion handler for that particular allegedly non-blocking event. But non-blocking does fundamentally change the API. So it's, if you're used to using the Tomcat 7.1 and you want to go to non-blocking, then if you've got a large application, then there's likely to be a reasonable amount of work to be done to take advantage of those non-blocking features. But really, if you want scalability and you really want to scale your application, then you're going to need to use non-blocking. So that's the Java EE7 specific stuff. What I'm going to do now is move on and talk about the Tomcat changes. And the first one is resources. So under the bonnet in Tomcat, there are lots of different ways that you as a system administrator or as a developer can say, yeah, I know I've got this WAR file, but I've got this extra stuff that I want to include within my application. It might be some static files, some images that you're pulling in via an alias. It might be a bunch of JavaScript that you're pulling in the same way. It might be some classes that are in a different directory structure that you're pulling in via the virtual web application loader. You might be adding a repository directly to the web application class loader. Or you could just be taking advantage of the Servlet 3 resource jar feature. Now, all of those things do fundamentally the same thing, which is take a resource and make it look as if it's part of the WAR file. Unfortunately, every single one of those features is implemented differently. It is incredibly fragile. It's very, very prone to breakage, as we discovered the hard way when the virtual DIR context and the virtual web app loader were added. And I think it took us two or three releases to get all the various regressions fixed. And trying to do Servlet 3.1 overlays on top of that was not going to be pretty. So what we did was essentially all of those things listed under resources, we threw out the implementation of that, and we've put in a new resources implementation that's common to all of those features. Or specifically, we've actually removed all of those features and provided alternative ways to do the same things through the new resources implementation. So it's new configuration, new attributes in the context.xml file. The idea behind that was it would then be very simple to implement overlays on top of. Unfortunately, as I said, overlays got removed, but this new resources implementation is there, it's available, and it's now a consistent way for you to put resources into the application. And it also lets you answer questions that, to be honest, you would have to have gone and looked at the code to answer before. So, for example, if you're using the resources, if you've got a virtual DIR context and some aliases and a Servlet 3 resource jar, and they all contain the same resource, and it's all mapped to the same URL, if you request that URL, which one do you get? And the answer is, I don't know. I would have to go and look at the code. And to be honest, the code is so complicated, what I'd probably end up doing is actually writing a test case and trying it to see what I got, and then trying to figure out why on earth I got that particular resource. But with the new resources implementation, there is a very clear order of precedence. So you can say, right, these get looked in first, then this, and that sort of ambiguity about what takes precedence goes away. Another significant change is the non-blocking Java I/O connector is now the default connector for Tomcat. Primary reason for doing that is in order to support non-blocking I/O in Servlet 3.1, you obviously have to have fundamentally a non-blocking I/O layer, so the non-blocking connector is the default. We've also added some diagnostic information in the manager. That's mainly around SSL configuration. There's no particular reason this couldn't be backported to Tomcat 7, apart from the fact that nobody's got around to doing it yet. I've got some ideas for adding some additional features to that. It's actually a really simple sort of extension point. If you, as a user of Tomcat, think, well, you know, one of the pieces of diagnostic information I would find really useful, or I find myself looking at all of the time, if you've got a piece of information like that that you'd like to see in the manager, it's not actually that difficult to add it. Have a look at what was done for the SSL cipher stuff, create a patch, attach it to Bugzilla, and one of the committers will look to adding it. It's a fairly simple way to contribute something that could be potentially very useful back to Tomcat. Under the bonnet, we've done quite a lot of cleanup in Tomcat 8. Where we can, we've removed some duplicated functionality. For example, I think there was something like 8 different places and 8 different ways where we had code that was trying to work out where on the file system an app base was for a particular Tomcat instance. So that's all been put into one common place. So there's been quite a few changes like that. The manager, the loader and the resources, those are all things that are specific to a web application. You don't have a session manager at a host level. You have a session manager for a web application. You don't have a resource loader at the host level. It's per web application. So you don't have a class loader, and you don't have resources. All of those things are specific to a context. Looking through the code base, it was obvious that because those elements had originally been made part of a container, and a container is effectively the parent object of the context, the host, and the engine, there are lots of fairly unpleasant casts to context whenever they were being used. So we decided to bite the bullet and say, look, the only place they used is on the context, so let's move them from the container to the context and let's clean the code up a bit. So we were able to clean things up, get rid of a bunch of casts, get rid of a bunch of potential problems, and just tidy things up. And it stops people being able to create configurations that make absolutely no sense. So in Tomcat 7, you could quite happily add a session manager to a host, and it would just appear. It wouldn't do anything, but it would be there. It would be quite happy. And it would serve absolutely no purpose whatsoever, apart from wasting your resources. So all of those, as I say, been moved to the context and reduced that possibility. We've also moved the mapper from the connector to the service. Now, the mapper is one of those relatively low-level Tomcat internal components, but it's the component that says, I've got this URL, which engine, which host, which context is actually going to serve this request. And what we had was we had one of these mapper objects on every single connector. So if, as is often the case, you have an HTTP connector, an HTTPS connector, and an AJP connector, we'd have 3 instances of the mapper, all configured exactly the same way, all 3 having to be updated when an application was deployed, when an application was undeployed, and it was just totally unnecessary duplication. So that's been moved up to the service, so there's one mapper for the service, and again, it just reduces the memory footprint a little bit and makes it some slightly cleaner code. Internally, we've gone through and cleaned up IDE warnings, find bugs warnings, javadoc warnings, a limited set of check style warnings. We certainly haven't done all of them. When I switched to a new machine and I just turned on check style on the Tomcat 8 code base, there were in excess of about 100,000 check style warnings. So we haven't got rid of all of them, but we have focused on a subset that helps make the code a little bit cleaner. And the aim there is to add a few more over time, and we'll slowly work to getting a cleaner code base. The idea behind all of that really is to make the code a little bit cleaner, a little bit easier to maintain. And in going through it, we probably found 20, 30, just little edge case bugs that users may or may not have come across, that may or may not have caused anybody any problems, but we found them, we've cleaned them up. And now it's a lot easier. Certainly if you're using Eclipse with all of the recommended settings, if you're looking at the Tomcat 8 code base and there's any little warning, little sort of yellow exclamation marks, you know something's not quite right. And you know it's actually a problem because the code base should be clean. So it's all the aim here is just to make the code base that little bit easier to maintain, that little bit easier to work with, and so we can spot problems sooner. Find bugs, we've turned on all of the warnings. We haven't turned it to the absolute paranoid level, but all of the checks are enabled, including the non-default ones, and we've fixed all of the issues and marked the ones that as false positives that aren't. So again, it's all about just trying to improve the quality of the code, step by step, little by little. So let's go on to talk about timescales. Java E7 is due this spring. That's not going to slip. As we've seen already, if it looks like it's going to slip, then Oracle are just going to pull features from it, as they did with all the whole multi-tenancy thing, which is why overlays disappeared from the Servlet 3.1 spec. Tomcat 8, there won't be an 8.00 release until the specification is final. How long after really depends on how long it takes us to implement all of the features and get everything passing the TCKs. Based on what happened for Tomcat 7, I would say we're looking towards autumn this year. But it just depends, as any Apache project, people who work on it are volunteers. It depends how many people are working on it and how much time they have. But I would guess sort of a first Tomcat 8 release that's feature complete is going to be autumn this year. There'll almost certainly be some milestone releases before then. When we come onto the WebSocket, that's a lot closer to completion than others. So one of the things I can see happening is once that's complete, is there'll be a milestone release with a complete WebSocket implementation, so people can start using that and provide some feedback on that. So let's talk about progress. And we'll do these in the same order that I went through the various features. Servlet 3.1. We have a partial non-blocking I/O implementation. Philip's done this for the NIO connector. I've done some of the low-level prerequisites we need to do to basically do the similar thing for the APR connector. We obviously can't do it for BIO. We effectively have to fake it. That's all in place. However, as I said earlier, the WebSocket code is built on top of this non-blocking I/O. And one of the things that we've learned by implementing WebSocket is that there is a fundamental assumption in the Servlet 3.1 non-blocking API and of the people that are using it that it's perfectly acceptable to have threads writing to the socket and reading from the socket at the same time. And that's not an unreasonable thing to assume at all. However, the current Tomcat code is pretty much entirely written on the basis that there will only ever be one thread working with a socket at one time. And you can't actually implement the WebSocket spec under that constraint. It doesn't work. So we're going to have to do some refactoring. How extensive that turns out to be, it's one of those, you don't know until you try. And that's really the next big thing to be done after WebSocket is to get the non-blocking I/O stuff sorted across all of the connectors. So there's potentially a reasonable amount of work left to do there. HTTP upgrade is done. Overlays, the hard part's done, but we don't actually need it, but it's done. Changing the session ID, that's done. That was actually not done by one of the committers. A user said, I'd really like to help with that. They wrote a patch, we provided some feedback, they fixed the patch, we applied the patch. So that was all done by a contributor. The devs were involved in committing it and reviewing it, but the contributor did all the hard work. And it just shows that you can just pick a little feature that you're interested in or you want to work on, provide a patch for it, attach it to a Bugzilla entry, and get it into the code base. So there are lots of opportunities and places to help. The protection for uncovered HTTP methods, that's the issues with the security constraints that use the methods. We haven't done anything on that yet. We're probably going to have to, as I say, so there's another area of work there. WebSocket, that is mostly complete. It does pass the Autobahn tests for all three connectors, as long as you don't use SSL. If you use SSL, the blocking I/O one works beautifully. The NIO finishes with a few failures, and APR crashes. So that's currently a work in progress. And once I've finished the latest refactoring to update Tomcat's implementation to the new version of the spec, then looking at what's going on with the SSL connect, the SSL versions of that is next on my list of things to do. This slide is slightly out of date when it says encoding and decoding is the largest block of functionality left. Encoding's been done. That was the simple one. Decoding is a little bit more complicated. That still needs to be done. But all of the WebSocket stuff should be fairly quick. The one thing that isn't on there is the ability on the client side to take a POJO and say, right, make this into a WebSocket client, please. I believe all of the various bits of plumbing that you need, all the various bits are there. It's just a case of putting them together in a class or two. So it should be fairly quick to do. Again, that's another opportunity for somebody to contribute. In terms of EL 3.0, haven't done a thing. Absolutely nothing. So there's an entire spec there that needs implementing. The good news is a fair chunk of that is writing the grammar that's then fed into the parser generator to actually parse the EL expressions. Last time I checked, the EL specification includes a copy of the grammar, which makes life a whole lot easier. I would say it's worth checking it, because there were some bugs in earlier versions. But if you wanted to get involved in the expression language, then there's obviously a huge piece of work to be done there. And to some extent, the hard part, the grammar's been done, and then you're into, well, there's then 20, 30, however many functions there are that need to be implemented, and you can pick a function, implement it, or implement three or four or however, whatever you're interested in. So there's again, lots of scope to get involved there. The JSP stuff, well, we haven't seen the spec, so we've got nothing to implement yet. I'm not expecting very big changes there. That should be pretty quick. Again, it's something that somebody who wants to contribute to should be able to contribute to very easily. So, some final thoughts. Java E7 technically isn't final. It's still a moving target. We're getting closer to the point where it's going to be published. So I think things are more certain than they were a few months ago. But it's still not beyond the realms of possibility for something to be pulled at the last minute or a significant new feature to be added at the last minute. To be honest, it's more likely that something will be pulled, but anything's possible. Tomcat 8 does depend on volunteer effort, as do every project at Apache. So if you want to get involved, you want to contribute to Tomcat, there are lots of opportunities to do so with Tomcat 8. This is potentially, well, less of an issue, the community agreement, that the resources refactoring, that was a big change. That probably took the community the best part of a month, I should say, to go from here's a proposal to, okay, yeah, we're happy to rip out all of that code and replace it with this new implementation. Understandably, there was a lot of nervousness about doing that, so it took a while to get to an API that people were happy with, to get to a feature set that people were happy with, and get to some performance that people were happy with. There might be a similar largish piece of work to get the connectors working properly to support the non-blocking API in Servlet 3.1. So that might be another one of these things that just takes a little time to go through the process to get to the point where all of the committers are happy with it. So we definitely want help. It can be to implement a new feature, fix bugs, clean up the code, point out the fact that we're doing the same thing in five different places and it would make sense just to do it in one. More tests. One of the things that Tomcat 7 added was the ability to embed Tomcat in other things, and that's made a huge difference to our unit tests. We have far, far more unit tests in Tomcat now than we did a few years ago. And that stems from having that embedded class. But it means unit tests are much easier to write. So if there's a particular bug, even if you can't fix the bug, if you can write a unit test that demonstrates it, that's an enormous help. The other area of testing that is incredibly useful is when the developer community publishes a release candidate on the developer website, on developer mailing list. It's really, really helpful if folks can download that release candidate and test it with their applications in their environment. It helps everybody. It particularly helps us in that we get feedback on regressions early, but also it saves you going through the rigmarole of, oh, great, there's a new Tomcat release. I'll download it. I'll test it. Oh, there's a regression. Oh, well, I'll just have to wait another month for the next release when that regression's hopefully fixed. If you test it before we have the release vote and before we say, yep, that's an official release, then we get that feedback much earlier in the process, and then we can say, okay, yep, that release candidate's broken, we can fix the regression and get that fix into the next release, so you get the working release sooner. So people who download the release candidates and test them with their apps and send a plus one to the mailing list, it is incredibly useful. We probably don't make our thanks and our appreciation on the dev list obvious enough, but it is very much appreciated and it is a very big help. Documentation, Plenty of scope to help out there, whether it's fixing typos, or if anybody has a burning wish to completely restructure the documentation so it looks like it wasn't written in the 1980s, that would be great. We know it's very dated. It's just finding somebody with the time, the inclination, and the right skill set to update it. If you think that person's you, please come and talk to one of us. We can happily point you in the right direction and sort of give you some of the ideas that we've had and some of the constraints we have to work within. But again, lots of different ways that people can contribute and people can get involved. Okay, that's me finished a little bit ahead of schedule, but at this point I'm happy to take questions from the floor. Oh, for a minute I thought I was going to get away with that. Apparently not.
You've done one of my favorite things, which is throwaway code. Have you noticed any significant increase in performance or?
Not particularly, but I get in terms of, I too like throwing away code. I am never happier than when I'm just deleting stuff we're not using. I think where we're really seeing the benefits is more in terms of maintainability than in performance. And we've had some changes during the life of Tomcat 7 that really have impacted performance, but those have usually just been awful pieces of code that have been rewritten. I'm talking tomorrow about security vulnerability handling, and there's in the good, the bad, and the ugly talk, there's an example there of a denial of service thing. It was basically down to awful code on our part, but throwing that away has helped performance. But generally, there's not a huge amount of fat that we can throw away. It's already been pretty much trimmed down. We have had, getting back to opportunities to contribute, the good folks at eBay who have been using Tomcat for a while have raised a number of enhancement requests and bug fixes around the JSP engine. And there's actually been some quite, they've all, for their environment, they're all completely valid. We do this, our environment runs faster. But it's one of those interesting, yes, that will work for everybody, that will work for everybody, that one won't. And then it's how do we solve the problem they're seeing without effectively over-optimizing and making it worse for a simpler case. So that was a good example of a contribution coming into performance. But generally with the cleanup, I think it's maintainability and ease of bug fixing that's been improved rather than raw performance.
To that end, it's also easier for people who are coming into the code base to try to figure out what's going on.
Definitely.
If they want to know, how do I get from point A to point B, particularly with the resources implementation, the new resources implementation, if you wanted to know how your static file got from the disk to your response, there was really no way that a mere mortal was going to figure that out in the past.
No. At least now, hopefully, you can follow the code and figure it out. But it was a nightmare before. All I used to do was just put liberally spread breakpoints throughout the code and hope that one of them would hit. Trying to debug it was horrible.
So I've got a couple of questions for you, Mark.
Shoot.
Essentially in presentation order. You mentioned that overlays were dropped from the spec. Is that something that you think that the experts group as a whole decided that it just wasn't a good idea, or that it wasn't fleshed out enough and it might appear in a future spec?
Okay, the experts decide. Yeah, this is the servlet spec we're talking about.
Yes.
Oracle decided that they wanted it in, then Oracle changed their minds, to be honest. That's
okay.
How it happened. It feeds on from the multi-tenancy stuff. So Oracle decided they wanted multi-tenancy in Java E7. That flowed down to the various specifications for servlets. That flowed down in the form of overlays. Oracle then decided that they didn't, so it all got pulled. So the experts really had not a great deal of say about whether it was in or whether it was out. There was a little bit of debate amongst the experts around what it should really be and how it should work, and whether multi-tenancy was something that a servlet container even needed to bother worrying about. But it really didn't get down to anything concrete, because it was pulled before the expert group really had come to a conclusion of what they thought the API should look like.
Okay, but so do you have a sense at all of whether it might be considered in the future, or is it just really a backup to Oracle?
Toss a coin. Okay. If I'm, from what I've seen, multi-tenancy is going to come back in, but whether, you know, in 2 years' time, it's still the sort of the same concern that it was when it was put in the first, I just don't know. I think it's 50-50. Because again, it's how relevant it is to a servlet container anyway. I think overlays, they are potentially very useful. I think it's something that Jetty already does. It's something that Tomcat can now do fairly easily through its resources implementation. So from that point of view, there's a better than 50% chance it'll be in servlet 3. Whatever the next is. But the multi-tenancy driver, I really have no idea.
Okay. What's the minimum JVM version for Tomcat 8?
My bad for not mentioning that. Tomcat 8 will require a minimum of Java 7. Not because it particularly needs anything that's Java 7 specific. Well, actually, the code base does now, because we've done a whole pile of cleanup and taken advantage of some of the Java 7 features. But there's nothing that you couldn't implement in Java 5 if you really wanted to. But no, the minimum will be Java 7.
Okay, there's been some discussion lately on the users list. I think Nick Williams is doing some screwing around with what Tomcat 8 can do and what the JVM 8 can do. So he's been writing JSPs that will only work, for instance, with the 8 JVM, with the closures and things like that.
Yeah, and there is an outstanding issue that's been raised with running JSPs with Java 8 in that something goes wrong when the compiler tries to insert the debugging information into the class. We've yet to determine whether that's a Java 8 JVM issue, whether it's an Eclipse JDT issue, whether it's a Tomcat issue. And to be honest, that's kind of parked for a while until those things are a little bit more bedded down.
I think time may heal that wound. Also, some of the folks here might be interested in knowing whether Trunk actually works right now, not in terms of API stability, but in terms of like server stability. You probably wouldn't want to use it in production, but is it appropriate to pull it out of Subversion and try running your app on it for a couple of months?
In terms of Trunk stability, the aim with that is that it should definitely always compile. If it doesn't, Billbot yells at us. And we fix it. So it will definitely compile. It should largely work. To be honest, I would happily run the ASF's Jira instance on Trunk at the minute. But that's because I know the bit of Tomcat 8 that isn't very stable is the WebSocket implementation, and Jira goes nowhere near that. Everything else is very, very similar to Tomcat 7, so there shouldn't be any issues there. So it's certainly the sort of thing that you could happily run in a dev environment. But if you're going to do that, what I'd suggest is have the separate Catalina home and Catalina bases, and just make sure you've got a nice, stable Tomcat 7 release that you can drop back to if you hit a regression and you can't work around it.
Okay. Finally, can you comment on the wisdom of potentially using WebSocket with HTTPD out in front of Tomcat?
The wisdom of using Tomcat's WebSocket implementation with HTTPD in front of it is a really bad idea because it won't work. Last time I checked, there's no way to effectively pass through the connection through a reverse proxy for WebSocket, so it just stops working. I'm looking at some of the HTTPD committers in the room, and none of them are jumping up and down waving at me, so I believe I'm saying the right thing. It was certainly the case last time I checked, and I'm not aware that that's changed. Any other questions? We've still got a few minutes left.
Okay, so we have lunch at 15:15, and I'd like to probably do the usual and say thank you very much for the presentation.